possible. So he is advised that the Almighty is saying that I am going to reveal it in installments. At another place, the Quran says, لِنُسَبِّتَ بِهِ فُعَادَكَ. This Quran has to be revealed in installments so that your heart can remain content and it is educated in a gradual way. If I had revealed the whole Quran in one go, you would have not been able to bear the burden, because it's such a big responsibility that it had to be discharged in installments. So this is one of the other verses which the Quran says. And then again, we have this these verses of Surah A'la, which says, سَنُقْرِئُكَ فَلَا تَنْسَى إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ. Soon we shall recite it to you, then you will not forget except what God pleases. Which again is actually an assurance sounded to the Prophet that please don't worry that if you're going to lose any part of the Quran, if you're going to forget about any part of the Quran, and that has made you hasty and that has caused this hastiness, you don't need to be, because the Almighty says that I am going to recite the Quran completely to you. This is the same thing which is actually said in the Surah Qiyamah, Inna alayna jama'ahu wa Quran. I will recite the whole Quran to you, don't worry. So this is another verse which is exactly saying the same thing. سَنُقْرِئُكَ فَلَا تَنْسَى. And note, the word is once again qara. It was inna alayna jama'ahu wa Quran. I'll collect the Quran and recite it to you, and you have to follow the recital. And again, the word used is recital. Qara is again the same. It's the same qara which is سَنُقْرِئُكَ. I'll recite the whole Quran to you, and then you'll not forget except what God pleases. Which again means that once the Quran would be revealed, it would be rearranged. And if at that instant the Almighty wants to make the Prophet forget something, he'll do so. And that's what the Quran says, illa mashallah. You will not forget anything except if God wants you to forget something, and so that will discard that part. So if you go on to the next slide. So in
this really the last ayah, so if Allah wants him to forget something,
right,
is it not giving what Hazrat Umar was saying about that stoning ayah, that maybe it was in the Quran before, but Allah wants him to forget?
Well, one can make a case out of that, but the stoning verse in itself has been discarded simply because the words of the verse, they are not Arabic. The word al-battata is one of the words which is used, and it was never found in the times of the Prophet. It is basically a word which was actually coined in Arabic about 200 years ago. We know the origin of the word as well. So there are some other considerations regarding that. Here actually we do find that there must have been certain verses which the Prophet was made to forget, and they still existed, and they became the source of these variant readings. So that is a separate case. But as far as the Rajam verse is concerned, that's an entirely different thing. But other than that, there could have been other verses which maybe the Almighty wanted them not to exist in the final revelation, and he caused them to forget, but somehow they remained in some of the codices. So I'll explain that later on, that could have been one cause of these variant readings as well. Okay, now the question arises that if Farai Saab's view is that the Quran was read out in various installments, it was revealed in various installments, and in each Ramadan of the life of the Prophet, there was this discussion between Gabriel and the Prophet in which the Quran which was revealed till that time, till that particular Ramadan, would be arranged and revised. Then there came a time in the last Ramadan of the Prophet in which the Quran perhaps was completed before that time. And then we know from hadith and history literature that this was the only time when the Prophet actually sat for itikaf for 20 days. Normally he would sit for 10 days.
What is itikaf?
Sitting in the mosque in Ramadan for the last 10 days in which you devote yourself for the worship of God. So the last Ramadan actually he sat down for 20 days, and this could account for the fact that the Quran was revised twice, because there are narratives which tell us that in the last Ramadan this double revision took place. Once Gabriel recited and the Prophet heard, and once the Prophet recited and Gabriel actually corrected him. So the question which arises now is that if the Quran, according to Farahi, is claiming that it had been collected, it had been given a new sequence, and then that sequence was given to the companions, then was it given in the form of written codex? Did we have a book like we have books like the ones we are used to? Was the Quran written down in the form of a bound volume and then handed over? Was it like that? The answer is no, it was not like that. The Quran was actually transferred to the living tradition of Muslims, in which it was read, it was read out. Read means people reading it themselves. Read out means to reciting before others. It was heard, it was written, it was memorized, it was taught. So these are the various vehicles, various means which the Prophet adopted in transferring the Quran, as if he was transferring the Quran to his students. So the Sahaba or his students would write down the Quran, they would hear the Quran, they would read the Quran, they would read out the Quran to other people, they would memorize it, they would teach it to other younger companions and to other converts. So in this way, the Quran was actually transmitted in its oral form, not the written form. The written form was basically like a personal note made by various students. So it was not that the Prophet left behind a written copy. The Prophet did not leave behind a compiled written copy. It was basically personal collections which the students themselves wrote down for their own selves, for their own consumption. But as far as the Prophet was concerned, the way he transmitted, the way he gave this Quran to us was in the form of a living tradition in which a lot of people would hear, write, read out, memorize and teach the Quran. So I would say that the Quran was transferred to the living tradition of the Muslims, primarily in its oral format. And that has been continuing ever since that. But we'll talk more about that in the second part of our presentation, when we will deal with the variant readings. So now let's move on to the next slide, please. Okay. Now, this is the report of a very famous historian and a very famous scholar of the Muslim Ummah. He's called Badruddin Zarkashi. Now, this is a statement that he has made on the authority of Abu Abdul Rahman As-Sulami. Abu Abdul Rahman As-Sulami died around 72 Hijra, and he is supposed to have been a student of one of the students of Usman radiyallahu anhu, and he is thought to have been the leader of the prayer of Muslims in Kufa for about 40 years. Now, this is what he has said. And please read it with a lot of care, because we are going to build upon this quotation from Zarkashi and see how the rest of the Ummah has taken it up. So it says, Abu Abdul Rahman As-Sulami, the same person, said, note the words that he says, the reading of Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, Zayd ibn Sabit, and that of all the Muhajirun and the Ansar. You see, he has not left out anyone. Muslims in those times were either the Muhajirun or the Ansar, and he has even named the prominent people or the Sahaba in those times. He says it was the same. It was the same. There was no difference. Now, of course, this could be a startling statement, because on the one hand, we have Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman giving various versions of the Quran through other Sahaba, and on the other we have a person who is living about 30 to 40 years after these personalities had died and telling us that when I was alive, when he was alive, of course, the reading of every person that he came across was the same. There was no difference. And see what he says, they would read the Quran according to the Al-Qira'atul Amma. Now this is a very important term. Our earliest scholars called this qira'at that we are so used to as the qira'atul amma, which would mean the reading of the masses, al-qira'atul amma, how the masses will read the Quran. And look what he says after that. This is the same reading which was read out twice by the Prophet to Gabriel in the year of his death. The same we are just talking about in Ramadan. And look what he says ahead. Zayd ibn Sabit was also present in this reading called the Al-Arza Al-Akhira, and it was this very reading that he taught the Quran to people till his death. Now there are two very important terms that you need to maybe make a note of, and one of them is called Al-Qira'atul Amma. So you see, our earliest scholars actually called the reading that we are so used to as the Qira'atul Amma, which means the reading of the masses. And the second important term is Al-Arza Al-Akhira, which means the final review, or that 20-day period in which Gabriel and Muhammad had this discussion on the final format of the Quran. And that particular session in which they would be having discussions for those 20 days is called Al-Arza Al-Akhira. Arza means presentation, review. Akhira means the final. So the final presentation, this is one word to note, one expression to note. And another expression to note is that our earlier scholars would call the qiraat that we are used to not the qiraat of Warsh, not the qiraat of Qalun, not the qiraat of Hafs, but Al-Qiraatul Amma. Okay.
Good. Just a point on this. So there's one name missing in here, which is
Ali. So you see, it's not a case of he being comprehensively noting all these people. It's basically his version of the fact that he could not find any significant difference between it, between anyone of importance. Could you move ahead? Okay. Now comes the very important question and the very important area which I am now going to explain before you. Could you move ahead, please? Now present is the other interpretation of the Surah Qiyamah verses, which is essential for you to understand, because unless you understand this, you will not be able to appreciate the huge contribution which Farai Sahib has made in one simple go by saying that Inna Alayna Jamahu wa Qur'ana means that the Qur'an was collected and therefore it was given a new shape at the end. And hence, it's a very simple matter of reconstructing the history of the Quran from the Quran itself. Okay. So, this particular narrative from Abdullah ibn Abbas is taken from Imam Bukhari's Al-Jami' al-Sahih. So, as I said, Abdullah ibn Abbas is one of the premier scholars of the Quran who has actually explained many, many verses of the Quran. And whenever technically a Sahabi explains something from the Quran or narrates something, it is called Asr. So when the Prophet explains something tries to explain on his own part anything relating to religion, we call that explanation as Hadith. However, when a Sahabi does something without citing the Prophet, then that particular explanation is called Asr. So, Asaru Sahaba, Asaru Sahaba, that's why the term is Asaru Sahaba. But at times, the word Hadith is loosely used both for the Hadith of the Prophet and also for the Asaru of Sahaba. So, that's also a loose connotation. But here, particularly because Imam Bukhari has also cited this information in his Al-Jami' al-Sahih. So, I'd now like to present before you how the Surah Qiyamah verses, which we just discussed, vis-a-vis Farai Sahab's interpretation, have been generally understood in these 14 centuries. And as I said, I have read vastly as far as I could on this, and I haven't found a single mufassir of the Quran in these 14 centuries not citing this narrative when he actually cites that Quranic verse. Every single mufassir, every single exegete, from the earliest to the latest, he always cites this explanation of Abdullah ibn Abbas whenever that verse of Surah Qiyamah is discussed. Okay, what happens now is that these Quranic verses, which I just referred to you, have been explained in a specific way, and I am now going to break it up in various sections, because the way in which a companion would typically explain a surah of the Quran or verses of the Quran would be that they would themselves quote the one part of the verse, and then would actually go about translating or sort of explaining how they have understood. So remember, the verses were actually four in number. So could you please move back? Yeah, this one. So remember, we had four verses. Now each of these four verses has been translated by Abdullah ibn Abbas in a specific way, which is absolutely diametrically different from how Farai Sahib has actually interpreted it. Now here comes, Abdullah ibn Abbas narrates regarding the verse La tuharrik bihi lisanak. This actually is the first verse of those four verses, of that group of four verses. So it says, when Gabriel would descend with a revelation to the Prophet, he would move his lips and tongue, and this would distress him, and his anguish would be apparent from him. Okay, please move ahead. At this, you see, what happens is that these verses or these ahadith, they are generally called Sha'n Nuzul ahadith, which means ahadith which actually explain the reason why a particular group of verses was revealed. So, can you combine the first three, the previous one with this, the slide, please? Let's go back. Okay, what we are now doing is that we are trying to understand the interpretation of these very, very important verses of Surah Qiyamah, which are fundamental, extremely fundamental to the understanding of the history of the Quran. We have just discussed how Farahi Sahib has interpreted them. However, we are now going to make a comparative study and see how our contemporary scholars, right from the beginning till even today, interpret this, and according to them, it does not relate to the history of the Quran at all. So our contemporary scholars, first of all, they think that it does not have any bearing to the history of the Quran. It is, if in a nutshell I am going to express their view, it is the fact that at the time of the revelation of Surah Qiyamah, of these particular verses, just for these particular verses, he became very anxious. And he became very anxious, so the Almighty, through Gabriel, through the Archangel Gabriel, stopped him from this anxiety. And the reason for this anxiety, which they say, is because he thought that he'll forget the Quran that is being revealed to him. So it was because of this forgetfulness that might come across his, that might be the case, that the Prophet would become very, very jittery. So the fact that he might lose any of the Quran, he would be overwhelmed with this emotion that I might lose the Quran, I might forget the Quran. And this would make him quickly acquire the Quran so that he could quickly memorize it. So Ibn Abbas says that the Prophet has actually said that you don't need to memorize the Quran when it is being revealed to you. Don't worry, the Almighty says, Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana. We will collect the Quran in your heart. The word heart is not mentioned here, but this is how he explains it as we can go ahead. I am just first summarizing what Abdullah ibn Abbas has said, and then we'll go through it verse by verse. So typically what is being said here is that when these verses of Surah Qiyamah were revealed, do we have Surah Qiyamah? Can we have Surah Qiyamah, the first 14 verses?
Yeah.
That's fine. So you see, according to our traditional scholars, what happened was, imagine Gabriel coming down with Surah Qiyamah. This time he has to come with the installment of Surah Qiyamah. So they say that Gabriel started to recite Surah Qiyamah before the Prophet. La uqsimu bi yawmil qiyamah wa la uqsimu bin nafsil lawwamah, etc., etc. Till as Gabriel was reaching the 15th verse, balil insanu ala nafsihi basira wa law alqa ma'azira, and during these 15 verses the Prophet was actually absorbing it the way he would be revealing it. Suddenly near the end he started to move his tongue very fast. So during the time of Surah Qiyamah, when these verses were being revealed, our scholars say that this hastiness emerged in the Prophet at the time of Surah Qiyamah's revelation, right at that time. And when he was showing this hastiness, he was told, please stop, don't be hasty, you don't need to move your tongue. If you think that you're moving this tongue because you're going to forget the Quran, that's not going to be the case. Now let's go to the slide. So the point that I'm making here is that you see, this is the 16th verse. Before this 15 verses were revealed, and during the revelation of those 15 verses, as the revelation progressed, the Prophet became jittery and anxious. And suddenly he became so anxious that after the 15th verse, instead of revealing the rest of Surah Qiyamah, which actually goes on after verse 20, suddenly the Almighty said, oh, please stop. It's like on the spot, sort of an admonishment that please don't move your tongue. It's like it's not the part of your content of the revelation, because as I said, Surah Qiyamah begins with a particular subject. That particular subject is regarding the hereafter, and during the revelation of that subject, suddenly the Prophet becomes very anxious. And at that very instance, instead of moving ahead with Surah Qiyamah, the rest of the revelation, which would be after verse 19, the whole Surah stops. And instead of continuing with the content, the Surah diverts and asks the Prophet, don't become hasty. Because the reason for your hastiness is that you might lose the Quran. You might forget the Quran. Don't worry, you will not forget it. It is our responsibility to correct it and then to collect it in your heart, and then you will read it. And when you will read it, you will never forget it. And when Gabriel goes away, you will still have it in his mind. So therefore, it is essential for you to hear what Gabriel tells you. Now, this in a nutshell is how the traditional scholars was interpreted. I have just summarized it. Now, let me go through this whole explanation bit by bit, part by part, and see how they have actually elaborated upon and then come into upon this collective interpretation. Okay. So the verse is, as I said, what happens is in these narratives, each part of the verse is split, and then each split part is explained separately. So it says, Ibn Abbas narrates regarding the verse, do not move your tongue. When Gabriel would descend with a revelation to the Prophet, he would move his lips and tongue, and this would distress him, and his anguish would be apparent from him. There are some other similar verses, similar narratives, which say that this anguish and this distress would be because he would think that the revelation that is coming down, I might forget it. So the distress was not because some other reason, but because he thought that the revelation that he's receiving now, it might just vanish from his memory. So at this, the Almighty revealed the verse of Surah Qiyamah, لا تحرك به لسانك لتعجل به. And then Ibn Abbas explained this and the subsequent verses thus, do not move your tongue to hastily acquire it. And then he said, Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana. This is what Ibn Abbas is actually explaining regarding those verses. So the next verse is, Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana. He says, it is upon us to collect it in your heart. You can see this addition in your heart, fi sadrika. It is right here, Inna alayna an najma'ahu fi sadrika. Sadr means heart. Sadrika means your heart, fi means in your heart. But you cannot find this in the Quran. The Quran only says, Inna alayna jam'ahu, we shall collect it. The fact that that collection is going to be made in the heart is an addition made by Ibn Abbas. It is not present in the original verse. Are you getting the point?
And this is not an alternative reading.
This is not an alternative reading. This is an explanation. So Ibn Abbas is actually telling us that the Prophet was being stopped to move his tongue anxiously in a very hasty manner because the reason that he was moving his tongue hastily was that he feared that he might lose the Quran from his memory. So the Almighty, on the contrary, is telling him, don't be so hasty. I will collect the Quran in your memory, because of course sadr means heart, and heart actually signifies the memory. Don't worry. Inna alayna an najma'ahu fi sadrika. It is upon us to collect it in your heart. Fataqra'ahu, and then you can read it. And let's go on. Faiza qara'nahu fattabi' Qur'ana. Then he further revealed actually the next part. This is the third verse. This is how he actually explained it. Faiza qara'nahu, when we reveal it, listen to it carefully. Anzalnahu fastami'lahu. So, in other words, what he is being admonished upon is that when you are receiving the Quran, instead of being hasty, just patiently hear what you are being told, what you are being communicated. Just patiently hear, and then you will listen to it carefully as well. And then the final verse, which says "Inna alayna bayana," which actually means this is our responsibility that you recite it. It actually means nubayyinahu bilisanika, which means that we shall explain it to you through your tongue. We shall explain it to your tongue. Nubayyinahu means to explain something, and nubayyinahu means that particular thing, and bilisanika would mean through your tongue. And then the narrative says that the Prophet would then be silent when Gabriel came and would recite later as promised by the Almighty. So this is actually, in a nutshell, the whole explanation which is offered by Abdullah ibn Abbas. And now I would like to tell you how the two are different. Of course, whilst I was explaining that, you might have noticed a basic difference between Farai's interpretation and Abdullah ibn Abbas. But now let me make it more precise for you. You see, if you take Farai Sahib's interpretation, Farai Sahib is actually implying the fact that the Almighty is revealing various installments of the Quran in various instances. And these installments have made the Prophet very anxious. The fact that the Quran is being revealed in installments has made the Prophet very anxious, because the non-believers would object that why are these installments being given to us? Why not the Quran is given to us in one go? Another reason for his anxiety was that he wanted the whole of the Quran as soon as possible, so that he could answer his critics and also be revealed of his responsibility. Still another reason for anxiety would have been the fact that he wanted to have the whole Quran memorized and placed in one place, or arranged in one place. So Farai Sahib's interpretation basically revolves around the fact that the word jama, collection, it's the same word that we use in Urdu, actually refers to the various installments being jama together, being collected together. This is one interpretation. Now, another interpretation is of Abdullah ibn Abbas. And he says that it is not the case that various installments are becoming a problem for the Prophet. It was the fact that a single revelation came to the Prophet, Surah Qiyamah was being revealed. Here the fact is that this was a permanent state of the Prophet. It became a permanent feature of the Prophet that he would remain very, very concerned that how these various portions of the Quran, what will become of them, how they will be arranged in one whole part, referring to the complete revelation. On the other hand, Abdullah ibn Abbas says, it's not a case of various revelations being combined together, or there is anxiety about that. The Prophet actually, while Surah Qiyamah was being revealed, it was being revealed, at that very instant, he became very anxious, because he thought that the Quran which has been revealed previously and which is now in his heart, in the heart of the Prophet, he might lose that Quran. He might lose that Quran which is previously found in the Prophet's heart. And so therefore the Almighty is telling him to please don't show any concern. We will gather the Quran in your heart. It is so you can see the difference here is, in one case, the different parts of the Quran which had been revealed previously were there, and the Prophet was being assured that all these disparate parts will be brought together and you don't have to worry about them. This is how Farai Sahib interprets it. Abdullah ibn Abbas says no, on the other hand, or allegedly he says that actually it is just the case of a particular revelation which was being revealed, and the Prophet is being assured regarding that revelation that don't worry, that revelation is going to be collected in your heart, you're not going to forget that. So in other words, one reason is forgetfulness, and the other thing is that the word jama here does not mean collection the way it is collected here, but it means collecting that particular verse with the verses he already had in his heart. See, there are two different interpretations. One is the various verses of the Quran have been revealed, and the Prophet is being assured that all those verses which are now being revealed in various installments will be brought together once. And not only brought together, they will be given a new sequence. And not only given a new sequence, they will be even recited out. So therefore, don't worry. This is one interpretation. Another interpretation is, it was just a momentary issue. Here it was a permanent feature of the Prophet's life. He had become anxious and very, very concerned about all the parts. Here it is said, no, it's not the case. The whatever you have already memorized, you will not forget it. And the new revelation that is coming down to you will also be memorized by you, and you will have it in your heart.
Where did you get this from, that he's talking about only this particular surah, that he will have a problem, he's got a fear.
The word jama.
Where he has got the fear only particularly about this surah?
This is how the hadith starts off. I have not quoted that particular hadith here because you see there are a number of ahadith. I have more concentrated on the words, because there are other hadith and other explanations which the scholars have interpreted it to mean that basically it was at that particular instance in which he became anxious. So this is how scholars have generally interpreted it. It's not that it is found in the narrative itself, but it is, this is how our traditional scholars have been very consistent in having that a single interpretation, that it was at the time of the revelation of Surah Qiyam, and it will become clear to you when I actually analyze it. So please bear with me, because although it's not stated explicitly, but there are certain things which actually lead us to this interpretation, and that is why each and every scholar of our ummah has actually confined himself to believe that basically it was because of the revelation of the Quran on that particular instant. Now, once that you have actually appreciated what the two mean, I will now critically evaluate. You see, at the moment what you have done is you have just heard what these two people say. Now we will analyze that, do the words of the verse also accept this interpretation or not? The next slide. Okay, so this is my critical analysis of Abdullah ibn Abbas's view. The first point is that the word jam used by the Quran does not readily accept its explanation offered by the narrative. If the issue, as the narrative says, was to assure the Prophet that no part of the revelation would be lost and the Almighty will collect it in his heart, why has the Quran used the word jam for this purpose? Why has that has it not employed a word commonly used to convey this meaning? And in Arabic, words such as hafaza, qara'a, sabata are much more appropriate for this purpose. So the first point of critique is that if the question was that the particular revelation had to be should not be forgotten by the Prophet, then the word jama is absolutely inappropriate, because the word jama is never meant to connote memorization in this particular context unless you have a special word. So the word jama would, when you say jama, it always means to collect different things which are found at different places. You say, I am going to bring that together. It's much more appropriate to speak of jama regarding various installments of revelation than to say that I will collect it into your heart. So the word collection in your heart has two problems. First of all, the word jama is not at all appropriate to be used for memorization in this particular context. And the second, which is more important, is that the word heart is not even found in the original text. See, this is an explanation which is allegedly offered by Abdullah ibn Abbas, that there is, when you say that an-najmarahu, for example, if the verse was an-najmarahu, there would have been absolutely no reason in the world to discount the fact that here the word najmarahu means to bring together its various parts. This particular addition of fi sadrika, in your heart, has actually been made by Abdullah ibn Abbas himself. It's not found in the original. When I say it's made by himself, I mean allegedly. So even if the word jama would, by any stretch of imagination, was appropriate for memorization or collection, then where has the word sadrika come from? Because it's not found in the Quran. And you can even see that in the absence of the word fi sadrika, they had to make this insertion, because in the absence of the word fi sadrika, it would have made no sense that we will collect the Quran. Where will we collect the Quran? So they had to insert this zarf, this locus, that this collection will be in your heart. So the second point of critique is that not only the word jama is inappropriate for memorization or coming together in one place when you talk of wahi, the fact that the word fi sadrika, in your heart, within the text of the Quran, does not even exist. And in the absence of such an indication, these words cannot be understood as an insinuation. So the point that I am making here is that either these words should have been present in the text. Otherwise, in the absence of their absence, how can we assume that the word fi sadrika is present? It's a figment of our own imagination.
So, I mean, does this relate to that narration which talks about four people who did jama of Quran?
No, that's an entirely different thing. Let's talk about that, because you see, that's another narrative which says that four people collected the Quran. Please concentrate more on the explanation of Abdullah ibn Abbas. I have summarized it here before you separately. Now we are going through it word by word. The next slide. Okay, remember this: what he said, Abdullah ibn Abbas. He said that an-najmahu fi sadrika wa Quranahu. So he says wa Quranahu means fa taqra'ahu. It is our responsibility to collect it in your heart, and it is our responsibility that you read it. Now, how can this be possible? Because the Quran actually does not say that you read it. It says, and it's reading. Quranahu means it's reading. So, the translation actually should have been in. So, if you know a little Arabic, let me just explain. The verse is like this. Inna alayna jama'ahu wa inna alayna Quranahu. So, this waw is actually just is of is just like the waw ataf, what we call the waw of ataf. So, it's saying that we will, it is our responsibility to collect it and it is our responsibility to recite it. So, inna alayna jama'ahu wa inna alayna Quranahu. This is the construction. When I say this, that the word waw is basically combining the two, this would mean that it is our responsibility to collect it and it is our responsibility to recite it. So, therefore, when you explain the word Quranahu with fatakrahu, that you recite it, then again this is not correct. Because in the verse, the Almighty is saying that it is His responsibility to collect it and it is His responsibility to recite it. On the other hand, when Abdullah ibn Abbas has sought to explain the word Quranahu, he has ascribed it to the Prophet that it is our responsibility to collect it in your heart, but it is your responsibility to recite it. It's never said that in the verse. The verse actually ascribes both the Jama and the Qur'ana to the Almighty Himself. The collection and the recital is the responsibility of the Almighty. Whereas here it says, we will collect it in your heart and then you will recite it. So, fatakrahu is not possible because actually the word recital refers to the Almighty and not to the Prophet. Takrahu means you recite it, O Prophet. So, therefore, this is the third critique that I would say, that the word inna alayna jama'ahu wa Qur'anahu are clearly ascribing the acts of jama and Qur'ana, collection and recital, both to the Almighty. Whereas the explanation, first of all, is deficient by actually ascribing the word jama'ahu, which is inappropriate, and it has to add the word fi sadrika, which again is not present. And then the second part is, the word Quranahu is actually referring to the Almighty, whereas the explanation is referring the Quranahu to the Prophet. Fatakrahu means you recited to Prophet. So the you is not present in the original. Okay, the next part. Okay, now the other part. The Faiza Qara'nahu Fattabi Qurana is interpreted as Anzalnahu Fastamir Lahu, which means when we reveal it, you listen to it. Now, this again is an absolutely fallacious thing and it cannot be possible, because you see, this has been a translation by combining or by actually positing anzalnahu fastami' lahu right with la tuharrik bihi lisanaka. Because you see, the translation is do not move your tongue hastily, la tuharrik bihi lisanaka. Instead, when we reveal it, you listen to it. So, you can clearly see that anzalnahu fastami' lahu actually relates to la tuharrik bihi lisanaka. It cannot relate to faiza qara'nahu. Nowhere in the world can it relate. Because you see, faiza qara'nahu fattabi' qur'ana is a verse which is preceding inna alayna jama'ahu wa qur'ana. In other words, when we say inna alayna jama'ahu wa qur'ana, faiza qara'nahu fattabi' qur'ana, this qur'ana and this qur'ana are the same. When you repeat the word, in the next sentence, by referring it to the previous word, in Arabic, the previous word always refers to the former word. So, in other words, when it is said, we will collect the Quran and we will recite it. So, therefore, when we recite it, you follow the recital. This is the natural sequence. It cannot be any other sequence, because this Quranahu is related to this Quranahu. It cannot be the fact that the word Quranahu, Fatabi Quranahu, actually means Anzalnahu, because first of all, Anzalnahu is an entirely different thing. When you say that Qara'nahu would mean we would reveal it, again that's not an accurate translation, because Qara'nahu means we would read it. And the original words are Fattabi Qur'ana, follow the recital. How can the follow the recital mean Fastami Lahu, listen to the recital? So you see, Fattabi Qur'ana has been explained by Abdullah ibn Abbas as Fastami Lahu, follow the recital, listen to the recital. Again, that does not make sense. When you say follow the recital, it means you have to follow it the way you recite it. You have to be obedient to, you have to actually not make any addition or subtraction. You have to be faithful in your recital. So, the word fastami' lahu again is inappropriate here. And could we move ahead, please? Again, I have already made this point that the word fastami' lahu is also inappropriate. And again, lastly, it says inna alayna bayana, summa inna alayna bayana. Sorry, this has been a misprint. It should have been here, summa inna alayna bayana. So, It Abdullah ibn Abbas's narrative actually explains this by saying that summa inna alayna an taqra'ahu, it is our recital that you read it. Now again, this is a repetition, because remember earlier on, if you go to the previous slide and the previous one here, so fataqra'ahu has already been said there, inna alayna jama'ahu wa qur'ana, that we will recite it, we will collect it in your heart, and then you will read it, O Prophet. So it means if you interpret the word Qur'anahu the way it has been done here, that you read it, it will be a mere repetition, because if you go ahead, you see fatakrahu has already been there. So why is there any need to repeat it? The next one, you see, again it has been said, inna alayna antakrahu. So what has already been said before, why is there any need to repeat it? It says that it's your responsibility to read it, and then supposedly it's saying it is our responsibility that you read again. It does not make any sense, and therefore it's a repetition that is totally uncalled for. And my overall comment would be that perhaps Abdullah ibn Abbas never uttered these words, he could not have, and it seems that they have been mixed up by the narrators, by people who followed him, and by the time this narration reached Imam Bukhari, all these had become jumbled up. And to add to my critique, I can also tell you later on, as I would do, that basically it seems that the narrative was wrongly ascribed to Abdullah ibn Abbas. He never said these words. And why I say this, I'll just presently explain. But let me first complete this explanation and go on to a critique of Farai's view as well. So if you look at Farai's view, you'll find out that his view actually does a lot of justice to the words of the Quranic verse. First of all, you see, the most important verse is the word jama. By any stretch of imagination, jama never refers to memorization unless there is some qareena, some concomitant indication. In the absence of that concomitant indication, the word jama means to bring together various things. So therefore, the first critique or the first point in which Farai Sahib seems to hold sway or prevails on Abdullah ibn Abbas' alleged narrative is that the word jama is absolutely inappropriate to be used here in this sense. The word jama can only be used regarding different parts to be brought together. And then it says, فَإِذَا قَرَأْنَاهُ فَاتَّبِعْ قُرْآنَ. When we read the Quran, when we recite the Quran, you have to follow that recital. So therefore, فَاتَّبِعْ is always more appropriate to be used as something in which it literally means. Ittiba in Arabic, we know it means to follow someone, to go behind someone. So therefore, fattabe here actually means that whenever I give you a new recital, which is what the Almighty is telling the Prophet, that whenever this new recital is made, whenever the new arrangement of the Quran is made, you will abandon the previous arrangement. You will only follow this new arrangement. Okay, the next point. And finally, you can also see that according to Farai Sahib's interpretation, inna alayna bayanahu, again there's a misprint here, it should be like here, so it should be here, summa inna alayna bayanahu, he says that the verses of the Quran like this, kazalika yubayyinullahu ayatihi linnas, these are actually verses which are found within the text of the Quran whenever there has been some explanatory verse of the Quran revealed. So he actually says that it does not mean that the Prophet is going to explain the Quran through his tongue, as is explained by Abdullah ibn Abbas's narrative. He says the Almighty is actually saying that whenever you need an explanation of the Quran, of any Quranic verse, I am going to explain it within the text of the Quran, not from any external agency. And this he has actually substantiated by saying that the Quran has actually done so at various instances. It's not my going out of my scope here, but I can give you several examples in which whenever the Quran has explained a previously given directive, it has referred to this and said, remember I had promised you that I'll explain verses which need more explanation. Okay, this is the promise, and therefore it says, kazalika yubayyinullahu ayati. This is how God fulfills his promise that we had said in Surah Qiyamah, that whenever a verse needs further explanation, he will do so. So therefore, we have this particular example. I can give you examples from the from exact Quranic verses and surahs, but that would be perhaps stretching. You can look it up in my book later on. And finally, we go on to the next part, in which we can say that not only the text of the Quran, not only the text of the hadith, Remember, we are always discussing two parts of hadith: the text of the hadith and the chain of narration. Or we have criticized the matan by presenting two explanations, one of Farahi and the other of Ibn Abbas. We have yet to actually take up the isnad criticism, and we have seen that basically Farahi's interpretation, in my humble opinion, satisfies the words of the verse very much, and Ibn Abbas's interpretation, as I'll show, is not even his own interpretation, is wrongly ascribed to him. But whoever is the person who has actually explained it, it does not do justice to the words of the verse. Now, coming to the isnad. Okay, now the problem here is that we find a lot of narratives in hadith literature in which things are reported from Abdullah ibn Abbas. So whenever Sayyid ibn Jubair, now Sayyid ibn Jubair is a student of Abdullah ibn Abbas, which, and he is the person who is actually reporting this narrative from Abdullah ibn Abbas. So if I draw the diagram of this narrative by Abdullah ibn Abbas, all the narratives, all the narrations have this chain of narration: Ibn Abbas, then we have Sayyid ibn Jubair, who's a Tabi, and then we have Musa ibn Abi Aisha. Now, this is again a thing that you need to understand on the basis of hadith literature. So, the point that I am making by actually criticizing the chain of narration is that whenever Sayyid ibn Jubair narrates directly from Abdullah ibn Abbas, he says Haddasani Abdullah ibn Abbas or Akhbarani Abdullah ibn Abbas, which means Abdullah ibn Abbas informed me, Abdullah ibn Abbas narrated to me. He always specifies by saying Akhbarani or Haddasani. However, when he indirectly narrates from Abdullah ibn Abbas, he either specifies the person between them or he writes in a way which I have just written, just saying An ibn Abbas. So he would always specify it by saying Haddasani Mujahid ibn Abbas or Haddasani Ikraman ibn Abbas, and this would mean that he does not narrate it from anyone else. And if you gather all the reports in hadith regarding this narrative, you will find that in every single report he is saying An ibn Abbas, An ibn Abbas, An ibn Abbas, which means that he is actually, there is someone in between him and Sayyid ibn Jubair which he is not naming. So I can easily say that basically on the principles of hadith literature, this narrative is not even of Ibn Abbas. It's basically Sayyid ibn Jubair's narrative, which he has narrated from somewhere else. And a further problem in this narrative is, as you could just move the slide, that there is a narrative which says that Abdullah ibn Abbas would actually move his lips the way the Prophet would move the lips. In other words, another problem with this narrative is that some variants reported by Abu Awana, Wazza ibn Abdullah, Yashkuri from Musa ibn Abi Aisha mentioned that Ibn Abbas told Sayyid ibn Jubair that he would move his lips the way the Prophet moved his lips, giving the impression that he had witnessed the Prophet moving his lips when these verses were revealed. Now the problem is that Abdullah ibn Abbas was not even born at the time of the revelation of this surah. He was 12 years old at the death of the Prophet. So at Hijrah he was barely a year old maybe. So how could have he said that I saw the Prophet moving his lips and he is actually imitating the Prophet? How could that been possible? So this is another problem which clearly to me tells very clearly that it is absolutely wrong to ascribe this narrative to Abdullah ibn Abbas. It is some other narrator who has mixed up these words and somehow ended up in Bukhari, in which you seem to have said, and he seemed to have said that Sayyid reported from Abdullah ibn Abbas. So in a nutshell, I can clearly say that not only the text of the narrative, is the way it explains the Quranic verse, is insufficient, incomplete, and not appropriate with the words of the Quran, but also the isnad of the narrative does not qualify to make it a narrative in which actually Abdullah ibn Abbas is explaining something. It is a mixed up narrative, and clearly because it has been found in the Imam Bukhari's Sahih, that our ulama and our scholars have started to believe in it, and whenever they read these verses of Surah Qiyamah, to them these verses do not belong to the issue of the history of the Quran. To them they belong to a particular category in which the Prophet was actually given assurance that he will not forget the Quran. As soon as the Wahi would be revealed, it will be collected in his heart, and so therefore he should be very careful in studying whatever Gabriel is revealing to him. Is anzalnahu fastamilahu, he should intently listen to what Gabriel is saying. For as far as the memorization of the Quran is concerned, the Almighty is going to have him memorized, and he will have the verses collected in his heart. Resuming our previous session from where we left, so if you would recall from the very beginning, from last week and also this week, the detailed heading of our topic was revisiting the collection and transmission history of the Quran. So I had divided this history into two parts. One is the collection part and the other is the transmission part. And remember, I had laid out those three points before you, and we've discussed actually the first two parts now. How the collection part, or how the Quran has been, the history of the Quran has been described in hadith and history and still held on by our traditional scholars, and how the collection part has been described by Faraisab and derived entirely from the Quran. So we have now completed one part actually, and that is revisiting the collection of the Quran. Now we go on to the next part, which relates to the transmission of the Quran, and how do we know that we have the same Quran with us, and why is it that it has so many variants, and why is it that so many countries, 11 of them, are reading different Qurans in their territories, and why is it that our tafsir books are replete with so many variants. But before I go on to the transmission part, let me make this I must point this out, that if you remember, we had discussed a narrative of Abdullah ibn Abbas while interpreting the Surah Qiyamah verses, and I had explained that in all probability its ascription to Abdullah ibn Abbas is unfounded, and also the fact that the questions which arise on the text of this narrative does not leave it worthy of any attention. Now I'd like to point this out, that the Isnad part, remember, in which we had discussed how Sayyid ibn Jubair reports from Abdullah ibn Abbas, and how there seems to be an inqita or a loss of connection between Abdullah ibn Abbas and Sayyid ibn Jubair. So typically, I'm just going to draw a small illustration. Abdullah ibn Abbas was reporting the narrative. We had Sayyid ibn Jubair at the second stage, and we had Musa ibn Abi Aisha in this third stage. And we had posited that Sayyid ibn Jubair, who is here, has actually wrongly ascribed this narrative to Abdullah ibn Abbas, and it seems that he has heard it from someone else and for some reason ascribed it to Abdullah ibn Abbas. Now, this particular discovery, or I would say particular clue which was given, was actually by a person by the name of Shabir Ahmad Azhar Merati. So as you can see the name, he belonged to Meerut in India, and he lived about 50 to 70 years from now, and he has a book which I would advise every one of you, if you can get hold of. It is called it's called something like that. Let me write it down here. Which says Sahih Bukhari ka ek naya mutala. It is in two volumes, and anyone who would like to understand what hadith criticism is, how scholars who have a very vast a very very discerning and a very vast intellectual ability, how they actually criticize narratives. So Shabir Ahmad Azhar Merati actually has written he's supposed to have written the a very large corpus, but unfortunately when he died, not all of it was published. So we have only two volumes of what he has published, and it consists of narratives in which Imam Bukhari has made some mistake or the other vis-a-vis its chain of narration. So anyone who would like to know more about how you criticize narratives, how is it that these narratives have been transmitted and still there are flaws in it, is advised that he should buy these two volumes available in Pakistan. I'm sure you might procure them here.